Oh my God. My lord, this film. This film. Oh my gosh. First off.
This film, oh my gosh. This film.
This
Oh my
film.
gosh.
Oh
This
my
film, oh my
gosh.
gosh.
This film, oh my
Oh my
gosh.
gosh, oh my gosh.
This film, oh my gosh.
There can be only one.
They're here.
I have come here to chew bubble gum and kick ass, and I'm all out of bubble gum.
Go ahead. Make my day.
Cinema Royale.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to yet another Cinema Royale commentary. I'm your host, Mike Mixtape, and with me is Morgan and James with me to watch another film. This time, we're watching The Last Action Hero. Boy, oh boy, there's a lot of talk about when it comes to this film. When it comes to production, that's something you should read on your own because it's interesting to say at least. It was even written into a book. It's very good stuff to read, actually. There's two versions of the script, the original version by Zach Penn, and then that Sean Black, oddly enough, because the original draft was actually parroting Sean Black. Sean Black comes in and rewrites it. There's other stuff, like there's a rumored point where the advertising was supposed to be on a rocket to be sent into space, and of course the box
Well, we'll
office.
talk about that later.
Okay, we'll get into all that goodness as we watch, whatever. I'll pop up with any kind of trivia as usual, and no wonder, because it's one of Arnold's little first stinker, to be honest. I mean, it's 37 Rotten Tomatoes as of now. I mean, it's something we gotta watch. Something we gotta watch. If you have not already opened your copy of The Last Action Hero, you could pull that up right now, queue it up, and I'll count down so you can sync it up to our commentary of the film.
And remember, if you have the crummy Mill Creek Entertainment Blu-ray edition or the DVD edition, remember, the audio is going to be shit.
You have that version, you've been warned.
Just
They have
throwing it out
that
there, just
version,
throwing it
it's
out there.
already too late.
It's too late.
Like, I've been reading Blu-ray forums, and it's like, oh! I've been reading, like, a lot of Blu-ray forums, and it's like, oh no, the Mill Creek edition, it's been downgraded! It's like half the same size as the Sony encoding, and it's true, they actually have the actual technical specs, and it's like, oh, good grief. So much for buying this movie.
Oh boy. Of course, this movie's been packed with a lot of action four packs. Anyways, here we go, and we're going.
Uh-oh.
I mean, of course, that's an action film. It's supposed to be a satire in action films of the 80s/90s. And we'll kind of get talking to that as we watch this film. In. And if you have not listened to a commentary, which I've done four previously already with these guys, what I'll do is count down from five, and once I say play, you hit play on your player to play the movie. So, in five, four, three, two, one, play.
So if you're playing
Say,
this
you guys
correctly,
mind
you'll
if I go
probably
make myself
see
a
the
sandwich for tomorrow?
1990s Columbia logo.
Columbia.
Hey, pretty lady. You guys mind if I take this thing downstairs so I can make a sandwich for tomorrow?
Go ahead.
Oh, irony, I want to make a sandwich too.
Oh! Shit!
I
Oh
get.
no, the movie's invaded.
Mind you, the soundtrack for this is amazing.
Yeah, for a movie that's supposed to suck, the soundtrack is quality.
I mean, on the soundtrack, there's a song, the AC/DC song Big Gun, and Arnold Schwarzenegger personally approached him to actually write the song for the film. They said a big gun base easy. They wrote it for this film because of.
Gee, Mike, wasn't there like a music video or something?
It could be.
Oh, get it? Because it was poking fun at another certain movie that was an action movie that made took place at Christmas.
Die Hard with a Vengeance?
You're two movies off, but close enough.
Yes, if you don't know already, John McTiernan directed this film, who has directed Die Hard, Die Hard with a Vengeance, Predator, and all that good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Whoa, check out my dead body.
I hope that's not a hostage.
Arnold considered this film his first real failure after an unbroken string of successes. He also considered it as the beginning of the end of his film career.
Yeah, and then Batman happened.
Well, can you blame him? He's walking all over police cars. He's
supposed to be a badass. Big loud police captain? Check.
Mm-hmm. Yep, it's like a combination of two characters from Die Hard and one.
Tina Turner, what are you doing?
She's the mayor of this place.
Ooh!
You are the governor, asshole.
Wait, this is my favorite part. This is my favorite line.
You want to be a farmer? Here's a couple of acres. Decker, next to our girl.
I don't understand the line, but I love it.
And he destroys the walkie-talkie with his hand.
Just because. Hey, it should have been a better manufacturer, but they sprung from JVC.
Okay, we're coming across an intense moment. I think here's the time I should explain something. It says here when they were doing the screenplay, they had to make a lot of changes, and I'm going to quote here from a book called Fiasco, written by James Orrin Parrish. There's a lot of nice entries here. The overall made the original narrative slicker and a lot more far out, but also decidedly more violent. Its text was now bursting with crude scatological jokes, including the revolving around a grotesque King Horde character named Leo the Fart. Commenting on their efforts, the Black Arnett duo said, and I quote, "We threw in every action movie convention we could, but it's not Naked Gun. No one pulls out a bazooka and says mine's bigger." The re-rate team labeled the results a cross between The Wizard of Oz and 48 Hours.
Mm-hmm. My goodness, John Malkovich has seen better days.
That's nothing. You should see him when he was doing We're Back, a Dinosaur Story. This is like right after he left. He was like, oh, brother, life sucks. I'm gonna get back at Hollywood for this.
Is that really John Malkovich, actually?
No.
Okay.
It's Noonan. Tom Noonan from Fright Night Part 2, The Wolfman from Monster Squad. And if I remember correctly, he was that uncle from Napoleon Dynamite. I made a joke about it in my review.
Yep. That does it. Step away.
I want the ones in your back pockets too. Empty them.
Oh, I believe there's one located up your rectum.
Consider this a Dun dun dun!
A bomb.
Yeah, right, Jack, right. You're gonna sacrifice your own child to get to me. I'm very flattered, Jack, but I doubt it. Andy, pick up the grenade. Come on.
Now, this grenade is very interesting.
It takes quite a long time to go off.
But it's also
Where's the kaboom? There's supposed to be an earth-shattering kaboom.
This one's made in Taiwan. What do you know?
It's a knife! That's not a knife, this is a knife!
That's not a knife, that's a motherfucking axe!
Ooh.
Ah, 3D!
Wait, it's a movie within a movie, okay.
No, no, no. Can't focus. The movie was about to get too dark there. Drat, I missed the original ending to Nothing Lasts Forever, the movie.
Let's see. On today's show, on NBC's Today Show, critic Gene Shalit wisecrack with the Schwarzenegger vehicle. It's supposed to be a movie within a movie. Turns out it's a movie without a movie.
Boom.
Damn.
How does that guy do it? I mean, Gene Shalit for crying out loud. He's got to be a genius. Did you know when he was interviewing Michael Cimino for Heaven's Gate, he kept questioning about how many starving orphans they could have fed with the amount of money he did making that movie?
Dang.
Yeah, he was pretty harsh. Oh, look, it's Robert Prosky. I never used to. He was that guy in Gremlins 2.
It's really Artie Lang in his final performance, so.
Silence, it's Robert Prosky!
Thank God, I just thought I should crank the fuck up.
Yeah.
I just watched it recently and I was like, oh my God, that is a dub version.
So. He's actually not a bad actor, too. He was in, again, Gremlins 2. He played the Grandpa Fred character.
Yeah, he was. Artie Lang is pretty good, too.
Before it opens?
Yeah.
Who do I have to kill?
Nobody. All you have to do is to get this
me.
School. It'll hook you a hurry. You're only gonna be 4 hours late.
Okay, this kid here, I don't even know what to say about him. I mean, who stays at a movie theater and not even go to school? For 4 hours?
Yeah.
For fuck's sake.
Dude, it's a movie. Mm-hmm.
Don't you think the psychological aspects of the character?
No. He's stuck in
the film. I'm guessing it's summer break 24/7.
I like some of the titles here in a. Oh, hi there, John Hughes. What's her name? Who played the nanny in 101 Dalmatians and Mrs. Wilson in Dennis the Menace?
Mm hmm.
Right.
What you are going to see is a scene from the film by Laurence Olivier.
Ah.
Some of you might have seen him in the Polaroid commercial, or as Zeus in the Clash of the Titans.
Oh, bosom sex.
Ew. How many movies within movies within movies?
Let's count. We got one, we got two.
There's gonna be.
Now, I kinda get the idea. This is supposed to be a commentary on, like, action films and how they sort of dull down the mind. Like, here you have him trying to understand Shakespeare when, actuality, Shakespeare had a different. Dialogue and execution. Okay, the bit with the flame there was kind of cool.
Big mistake.
I still want to see Schwarzenegger in a Shakespeare
Something
film.
Something is rotten in the state of Denmark.
It's
and Hamlet is taking out the trash.
I love
it's
this so
the
much.
It's the Willy scream.
Oh man.
Said unfair.
What the
okay, that was good. Something you notice really easily is that
good night.
Is that anyone who gets shot in this film doesn't bleed, which is very interesting.
Well, this is a PG-13 rating film.
Yeah, this is when Schwarzenegger was trying to shave himself off.
Yeah, well, because Schwarzenegger produced this film as well, so he wanted it to be PG-13 to appeal to a broader audience, you know?
Oh. Wile E. Coyote? What? What? Wile E. Coyote? What?
I can't explain. The entire movie is one giant cartoon.
It does make sense, actually. Especially when it gets to that point.
Hello, Sally Fields, who does not look like Sally Fields, because you are not Sally Fields.
Isn't that the nanny right there?
Why can't we do a commentary for Soap Dish? That's a funny movie.
Well, I'll just put that on my list of future commentaries.
Yay for single moms.
Yeah, it was done better.
Mm-hmm. You think?
Oh, I mean, yeah. Now, it's funny because I don't think the kid is really that bad of an actor. I mean, he was in Prehysteria.
Yeah.
And he was actually fond of that one. He knew that movie was ridiculous. It was mini tiny dinos. Here it's like, oh, I'm gonna be riding against Arnold Schwarzenegger, and I don't know if it's like the direction or something, but I'll probably explain it better as we go along. The fact that when he's inside the movie, he's trying to prove the fact that it is a film, and really what he should be doing is just having fun. I mean, literally, he's in the universe of a movie. He should be enjoying it, not being all like, oh, you're in a movie, you can do these all kind of things and all this sort of stuff, and trying to break the laws of reality or something.
Here comes a very, very, very dark scene.
Yeah, even as a kid, I was like, what the fuck is this?
This is, like, I don't know why this is even in the film.
My only guess is that I guess it's supposed to show how unexpected reality can be and how dark it is, but honestly, it just slows the movie down. Like, there's really no point. Like,
I don't know what's about to happen.
You well? Okay.
Ooh, jeez.
Yeah, look, there's that. You know what? If anyone needs me, I'm gonna go make a sandwich and be back.
You started the whole sandwich making business here, James.
Well, I have to, because I have work tomorrow. And I'm watching a movie with you guys.
It's fine. Totally understandable. It's a great snack to have while watching a movie. Whether or not you're making it for work or not.
Next, I'll make coffee.
What a douchebag. I mean, why would you even come to go rob some rich person's place, not some dinky freaking...
How dare you not have good enough stuff for me to steal?
Screamy Mimi?
Mm-hmm.
Take the bag.
I'm gonna go to the closest thing I have to a father figure. Art Carney. I gotta go to the bathroom first before I get in the movie. Oh, look, rain for dramatic effect.
Oh, Liz. Steven Spielberg was considered to direct this, but he decided to do Schindler's List instead.
I always wanted to be a magician. But then, still would. Then I work myself up.
Usher.
Close enough.
Mm-hmm. Yep, a lifetime projectionist.
Just a minute, young man. Aren't we forgetting something?
This 16 minutes in and this pops up, which is going to be the rest of the film otherwise.
Magical.
Magic ticket.
That is the biggest darn movie ticket I've ever seen.
You don't see movie tickets like that anymore. You just get a frickin' printed, handed out piece of crap.
It's a little nub.
Yeah. You don't get movie tickets anymore. Really? You couldn't.
I've got a golden ticket, nothing to do with it.
Run, Charlie, run, run far away.
To do a dem de la, give me the power, I beg of you.
For those people listening, there are three versions of the movie Ticket that they used in the production of this film, and the final version was not even ripped in and was sold by a private collector in Dallas, so we can't get it.
But maybe one day you can. Oh! She broke it!
You ripped it. How dare you? It's valuable.
What you gotta love about that also is how nobody, neither one of them flinch or anything when that happens.
Yeah. Franco Colombo. Colombio. Huh.
Yeah!
America, fuck yeah!
It's introducing the Meredith Caprice.
I guess. Jack Slater 4, this titling of this movie is unbelievably just a number, no subtitle. Like I said, the soundtrack to this film is amazing.
Mm-hmm. Must be a bad guy because he sounds Italian.
Because all Italians are bad guys.
I mean, I know you Jack Slater's favorite second cousin in the whole world.
Second cousin?
I don't know, but Slater knows.
That's ridiculous.
You're not fooling me with that fake blood. Did somebody fart back there?
We mostly talk muzzle philosophy.
Bullseye. And Charlie Dance. Charles Dance. Charles Dance. I love you, Charles Dance. There's a couple of things
about...
How do
you like my big gun?
There's a couple of things about Charles Dance I want to mention since you were first introduced to him. In interviews, he said that he was told he won the part because it was turned down by Alan Rickman because of the salary. And he wore a t-shirt on the set which read, I'm cheaper than Alan Rickman.
You could actually buy that in 1993?
He must have made it. Personally. There's no, I guess, I don't know. Also in the running for Benedict was Timothy Dalton as well.
He would have worked.
I could have seen Timothy Dalton doing that, but Charles Dance is really good. I mean, I loved him in The Golden Child, and he's great as the bad guy here.
Oh, hey, it's Satan from The Golden Child.
I was just talking about Charles Dance.
I guess I miss Robert Prosky's soliloquy there from The Page Master.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Hey, Austin Brighton, would you like an adventure? Seriously, I feel bad for Carney. They have to, like, beat him up and everything.
Who are you gonna pay?
Are you sure this is the right yeah, I'm getting into this movie now.
60 guys dancing on the lawn throwing cocaine and anthrax.
It's a low rent enough neighborhood. Looks like a could be a crack house.
What's up, guys?
Is that real crocodile leather?
You must be joking. My second cousin Frank lives in there. The only drugs you'll find in there are aspirin. If you touch the front door, you're gonna need them.
Hey, there's been a mistake.
I gotta go to the bathroom. Be right back.
Well, of course, I should probably bring up, just like an action movie sequel, they parody a lot of, like, the weird cliches and things they do to, like, expand upon. So it's like, okay, we can do this for a sequel. Like, the fact that there's always a revenge plot. And there's this relative brother that they never talk about in the previous films.
Mm-hmm.
Which is kind of weird. Now this whole
why they
thing...
left me alive?
Frank.
What? Why they left me alive so I could tell you this? I don't.
Now, the whole bomb thing, how does that even work? Is it like, was it always like pre-rigged or something?
I don't know how to act when a relative of mine dies in front of me, and not even my kid.
I think there's a refrigerator magnet attached to him. And now, an internet meme. I cannot tell you how many times they had...
Alright, there's your kaboom.
I cannot tell you how many times I had, like, tons of memes of Arnold going, it's a bomb, and then nothing happening.
That is pretty funny, but, you know, how... Again, how does that work? Are the cards explosive?
Maybe, like I said, maybe the bomb was, like, preset to, like, 60 minutes or something. What were we for it?
And homage to Lethal Weapon right there.
Oh, it's... So that's where your favorite line comes from.
Yes, but I prefer 2 days till vacation.
It's okay, I'm still awesome, I still have the AC/DC soundtrack, which automatically makes everything better. Who has dynamite?
And who has dynamite that came from Acme?
I was just gonna say all the props were labeled Acme.
Like, I know this movie's supposed to be a cartoon, but this is like a kid's perspective of the action movie. And speaking of which...
Which, that's totally CGI dynamite. Oh my god! It came through the screen.
Oh yeah, that looked real. Rats, popcorn won't put out the fire.
Nope, and he blasted into the film. Landed right into Jack Slater's car.
How does that even work?
Don't question it. It's more fun that way.
Don't shoot me. I'll get him out again. I'm a kid.
I'm Bart Simpson. Who the hell are you?
I guess you're right. The sound system was crap. I mean, he couldn't hear anything until the gun went off.
How did you get here?
I'm not quite sure where here is.
Still sounds like shit.
Close your eyes, stay flat, and don't move.
Still don't do shit.
I even screwed up the acronym on camera.
Oh, look at all these random thug actors they hired for this.
I'm driving with my ass.
My butt cheeks has an extra set of arms that come out once in a while.
You like my bubble butt in Terminator? Well, this
hey,
is how I work it.
Hey, hey, that ice cream truck had acne on it.
Mm-hmm.
It's not always a happy, happy day.
You just get iced.
Hey, that's my line, Cretan. You can't run the ice cream man, you little turd.
This is really happening.
Seriously, we gotta do something on ice cream, man.
This is not happening.
Yes, yes, yes.
No, don't touch him there!
Bad dodge, bad dodge! Texaco.
Yes, remember Texaco oil? So non-existent. Okay, fun fact.
Just put out the fuse with his thumb.
Yeah. By the way, when you saw the car tilt like that, they did a stunt like that in Daryl. It was pretty cool.
Mm-hmm. Say hello to my little friend.
So that's why they call it a minigun.
Yes.
Radical face!
Hollywood Reporter...
Oh, look, it's that... It's that turnpike, that bridge that ends up in every action movie.
Even a better movie called Judgment Day.
Which there's a subtle cameo, which I'll mention when it comes up.
Oh yeah, I still have problems with that.
Actually, another cameo along with them, which I'll mention as well.
Is that the one with Basic Instinct?
Mm-hmm. Coca-Cola, alright.
Life tastes good.
Drink Coca-Cola, kids.
Mike, when are they gonna fry the Coke?
A different movie, right. Morgan.
This movie jumped the Coke truck. Shaving, premature ejaculation, and your first divorce. Wait, did he say premature ejaculation?
Yes, he did.
This is a kid's movie, right?
It's a PG-13 movie.
No.
Because the only reason Schwarzenegger did this film is because he was trying to get like a family-oriented audience.
That was called Kindergarten Cop.
Yeah. He wanted to do a more broader audience with a PG-13 rating.
Girls have a... Oh, I almost fucked it up. Boys have a penis and girls have a vagina.
That's how the scenery changed, right?
Stop pointing out this is the movie, damn it.
And this is the main problem with the movie.
Yeah, he just rambles on about this is the movie, this is the movie. Shut up and enjoy it.
Just like Jackson.
Mm-hmm. I guess the idea is that the kid is trying to break reality, but at the same time, it's like, dude, you're in a movie. Kick back and enjoy the ride.
Your fingers? There's as many as you can.
Just like Jack Slater, because he is Jack Slater, you idiot.
Exactly.
Arnold is Jack Slater.
Mm-hmm. Curse. Oh, man. I'm no good at playing chicken.
Wait, how did it catch on fire?
Geeks pops a boss around, honestly.
Wait, what?
Ooh, hello. I don't remember this when I was a kid.
Hello?
Are you kidding me? It was in the TNT version.
I'm in the movie.
And I watched this movie on HBO. At a hotel. Talk about a ho-ho hotel.
Nick,
are you watching?
Something like cookies and dynamite. Thank you, Baskin Robbins.
Alright. Mm. Los Angeles Police Department.
Alright, James, how accurate are these police departments?
I wouldn't know.
Valet parking? Alright.
Okay,
Sharon Stone, Over. Basic Instinct. And Robert Patrick.
Oh, jeez.
Brief cameos, everybody.
Okay, I want to explain. If Robert Patrick was in a trench coat, I would have been fine. Because it messes up a later joke they have at the Blockbuster video store scene, which we'll get into later. But having Robert Patrick appear as, like, the T-1000 just makes it weird.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, is he really trying to save people, or is he really just doing something else and it's just a parody of it? Jack Campbell, Fat Camp. Sorry, I'm gonna say that. But no, when they do that bit with, like, the when Robert Patrick appears in, like, the same outfit, it would have made a little more sense if he was, like, in a trench coat or something.
And also, if this is supposed to be a bunch of, if this is really supposed to be that moment in an action movie where you have a bunch of cameos, let's keep this in touch here. If this kid had not put himself into the movie, what would those characters have served there? What would those cameos have accomplished?
Yeah, because this is Jack Slater 4, so those cameos in this movie within a movie would just make no sense.
Mm-hmm. They don't.
You know what would have made sense? If this movie was all a dream. Like, you just see the kid, like, surrounded, like, by VHS tapes of action movies at the end, and be like, what? Oh, it was all a dream. That's the last time I binged Lieutenant Decker. Yeah, it's a throwback to Frank Decker, the director of Monster Squad.
Mm-hmm. What?
Oh, here's some irony. Hollywood Reporter branded the offering, and I quote, "a joyless, soulless machine of a movie, nothing more than a noisy monstrosity."
Animated cat.
Oh boy, it's Roger Rabbit syndrome. Still alive in the 90s.
Fun fact, it's uncredited Danny DeVito.
Oh, it is?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, it is.
But for some weird reason, he didn't get credited for it.
Yeah, you can totally tell it's Danny DeVito voicing it. And later on, Arnold and Danny would do twins. Or was that before Last Action Hero?
Before.
Okay, thank you. I would have fucked up majorly on this. I have it on DVD, so I kind of know what it is.
Did Arnold just say he'll be back or something like that?
No, he says that later on.
Yes.
Oh, here's something interesting you guys probably should hear about. Let's see. Straight from the book Fiasco, in an unusual turn of events, Schwarzenegger, in his capacity as first-time movie producer, was the point man on all marketing and promotional materials, promotion matters relating to Last Action Hero. Each and every new ploy of the promotional campaign was brought to the attention of the star, who was headquartered in his impressive 40-foot trailer on the Sony lot. When it came time for Arnold to sanction the planned one-sheet post for the film, he insisted that Columbia's team go back to the drawing board. He felt that the action post should not have his hair flowing rather than tightly liquid. It was not publicity department under Linings who negotiated such approvals, or Schwarzenegger, but rather key studio executives who spent much of their day rushing to and from Arnold's command center. In fact, after one conference in Arnold's control bunker, Mark Canton only particularly joked to the star, and I quote, "Have your distribution plan on my desk tomorrow." The next morning, Arnold had a mock report delivered to Canton. While this interplay between them was in the guise of a joke, everyone knew there was no kidding around who was the real final authority on this shoot.
Oh, I could mention about the merchandising and the advertising for this film.
Oh, yes, Burger King had those weird motion cups, and then McDonald's had, like, those standard cups with Jurassic Park on them or something.
And so, now my flushing is on everyone's commentary for the world to hear.
We shall make it official for every commentary there will be a toilet flush. Let's make it happen!
Get a running gag.
Mm-hmm.
I lift things up and I put them down.
My goodness, is that a bondage count? Is that a bondage outfit back there?
That was, I think.
Yeah, there's that weird gag with like all the women and stuff.
But yeah, the merchandising people came up with some Jack Slater action figures with guns, but Arnold Schwarzenegger vetoed the idea since the last action hero was a warmer, more cuddly action film. Warmer, more cuddly action film. That's a weird sentence.
Then how do you explain the fact that they actually made the toys by Mattel?
I have no idea. The film had 7 video games, a $20,000 Burger King promotion, a $36,000 theme park ride.
What, a theme park ride? Where was I when that happened?
As well as a 44-story inflatable Jack Slater at the Canes, and Schwarzenegger gave 40 TV interviews.
Acme Video. Okay, this is confusing. It's supposed to be Acme Video, but it's obviously Blockbuster. Look at the background.
Yeah, okay, yeah. I want to actually stop to say...
Ooh, shh. Let it happen. Let it happen. He was more amazing than that one movie when he played that person in the Amazon. I think his name was Fox McCloud or McBain.
This kid has got to have it figured out. Of course, in a movie, he's not gonna be played by the same character, right?
Also, little hat trick. If you look really closely at a lot of the posters and VHS tapes, they're Columbia TriStar. No, actually they're Columbia Films. It's a staple for the film to literally load up like video rentals stores with nothing but like movies approved by the studio. A good example is The Fisher King, where you have that scene where Perry is like going through all the tapes and stuff, and they're all Columbia Films.
What movie is that being advertised on the TV? It looks good.
It's probably better than this one.
Oh.
Yeah, I went there.
But yeah, when Schwarzenegger advertised for this movie, he did 40 TV interviews and 54 print interviews in 24 hours, setting a new personal record.
I wonder what the casting process was. Okay, must have all thin, no fat women for this movie.
Listen, Let's see, assuming underway, there's no question in the minds of anyone born in Colombia that this complicated effects land movie needed every day of its 4-month shoot to complete its principal photography on time. However, there was a little margin allowed for the unexpected because Canton, in the grandiose display of recklessness, already had staked out June 18, 1983 as the picture's release date. Under the governing Hollywood rules, the major studios announced well in advance the release dates for their upcoming blockbusters, hoping to scare off competition from the opening their entries on the same prime play date. Winning the box office sweepstakes on a big film's all crucial first weekend was key to promoting the film to potential audiences in its subsequent weeks of releases. The supremely overconfident executive was unmindful that Steven Spielberg's science film Jurassic Park, already gaining tremendous industry buzz as the picture of summer 1983, was scheduled to open on June 11th. It's ironic that they named this movie The Big Ticket of 1993, too.
Mm.
Oh, one thing I forgot to point out, the scene where they were shooting on the, when they were doing the Hamlet scene, that was actually the leftover castle set from Coppola's Dracula.
Ah.
Good money saver. Oh, yes, I can prove it right here. Let's see. Season character, Robert Prosky as a projectionist, Joan Plowright as distinguished English stage film performer, widow of Sir Laurence Olivier, because that explains her cameo, because she was the widow of Sir Laurence Olivier, and, Danny DeVito was contracted to provide the off-screen voice for the cartoon cat police detective named Whiskers.
Hey, isn't that odd job?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Another cameo.
Yeah, I'm gonna read this bit here. Defer the boost the entertainment quotient, several celebrities were tapped for cameos. Among this group were Sharon Stone, Damon Wayans, Little Richard, Jean-Claude Van Damme, Tina Turner, Chevy Chase, James Belushi, and Arnold's wife, Maria Shriver. Sadly, few of these in-joke appearances had any impact, as the talent involved were stuck voicing bad quips or seen in tossaway surprise walk-ons that proved flat.
Oh, kind of like Robert Patrick and Sharon Stone back there, right?
Exactly!
Mm-hmm.
I mean, even I was saying, what was the point, even if this movie had been just a standalone movie, what would have been the point?
Hi, doggies.
This is a weird joke.
Well, I can imagine...
You want kibbles?
I can imagine dogs being trained to do something like that, you know, do a pyramid.
Movie, are you on drugs?
Charles Dance, I love you so much.
Okay, time for another book quote. Let's see. Most of all, the studio overconfidently believed that their magnetic star could sell anything to the public, including this by-the-numbers self-mocking picture. Arnold was counted on to glad-hand the press at every chance and to be the film's goodwill ambassador during production, and especially during the crucial initial release period. On one such thumb mission, he insisted in what might pass for double talk that his new movie was geared to please any type of audience. And I quote, "I thinking it's a thinking man's movie. It is safe enough for kids because we never really show any impact of bullets, no blood. We always cut away. It's kept within certain guidelines, although we kept the action in it. But at the same time, we wanted to make it intelligent to say something about action movies and how this character changes what impact the real world, the real violence has on him and when he goes back to the fictional character." Another time, the muscular spin master explained, again, "In a way, Last Action Hero is a spoof on the stereotypical aspects of action movies. It shows inside the movie and how tough movie heroes are. What I think makes it really work is that since I have done so many action movies in the past, now I can make it a spoof. It is a satire." In actuality, it would be this very element that was the film's downfall. Since gaining movie fame in the mid-1980s, Schwarzenegger had played most of his features with an engaging self the appreciation that moviegoers relished, as audience responded, proved in Last Action Hero there was nowhere to go creatively while parodying a parody which, in every element, including story, costumes, and sets, was a gross over-exaggeration. This heavy-handed overkill merely obliterated the foundation which Arnold had achieved box office fame.
Hmm. Ouch.
Yeah. I'm just quoting this to fill up time.
Of course you are.
Well, that's working.
Hey, at least it's getting everyone's money's worth.
What money's worth? It's a...
Think about the poor bastard who would have to buy this from Bargainman just to listen to this commentary. Or guy overseas who had to download this movie, like, to go an arm and like, hello, nurse.
Yes, hello.
Mm-hmm.
Bridget Wilson in her first on-screen film role. She was previously on Saved by the Bell.
Did she move on to anything else?
Yes, she also did Billy Madison, Mortal Kombat, as you may know, Sonya Blade.
Oh, that's Sonya? Oh my
yes.
goodness.
Yes, before Sonya.
The first Sonya?
Where are you?
Yes, this is her first film role. So I gotta say, she did TV before. I remember seeing her in Saved by the Bell previously.
Was she better than Elizabeth Perkins?
She was like a small character in the series, and she was like a dumb-witted, like cheerleader type, like, oh my god, kind of character. God, I love her.
By the way, what's up with, we probably should have mentioned this earlier, what's up with Arnold's thing in picking people up? Is that the way he picks up his women?
Could be.
Possibly.
I lift them up, then I put them down. By the way, Mike, is that beer or gallons of water you're drinking?
Water.
Alright.
Mmm. Is it hot over in Wisconsin?
Of course it's hot in Wisconsin.
Because as we all know, nothing's free in Waterworld. Ooh!
Snap.
I love that movie.
He said it, ha ha.
This is weird, the flashback.
Yeah.
Here's another action movie cliche. He's got all the flashbacks.
Yeah, doesn't he do, like, the Die Hard fall?
Yes.
That's a really dark ending to part 3.
Mm-hmm.
Why, again? What, not two times? What?
Yeah, one time makes sense.
One time is good enough. Oh my.
What? I guess that was an attempted at a joke or something. That he continued the flashback later in the day.
This movie is missing.
But what triggered it?
And we're living here in Arlington.
Don't open the door. Don't open the door.
Don't look in the basement.
Supplies! By the way, what's up with that running gag with his eye changing?
I don't think about his glass eye. No.
Yeah, like, just, in his first scene, he blinks, and it turns into a happy face, and he says, have a nice day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a mood changer, I guess.
It's
just a character trait, I guess. It's got so many glass eyeballs, I just like, I'm just shoving in whatever current mood I'm in.
Again, another weird joke.
Oh, yeah, don't hurt a hair on her.
Boink.
It's very cartoony.
Boink. Snap.
He played the guitar or something there.
Yeah.
That's what it sounds like.
Must have been insane contact lenses for Charles Dance to put on.
Either that or he just signed up for Cobra.
Cobra.
Wait. Director John McTiernan said the film began as a wonderful Cinderella story with a 9-year-old boy and a pretty good script, but the film didn't end as it began, referring to the film's troubled production and the fact that it opened in theaters a week after Jurassic Park. After the film's failure, McTiernan retreated to his home in Wyoming and took a break from his career.
Poor bastard.
See, you just missed the payoff. Your answer to the whole eyeball thing there.
Oh. Shit.
The eyeball thing was, he was supposed to say earlier that he could tell he was a bad guy because he had the target on his eye in the first scene that he appeared in. So mm-hmm. The fact that it was a happy face in the second scene he appeared in was an indicator that he was not the bad guy.
Huh.
Have I made sense?
Yes.
Because he told him the bad guy has a target on his eye.
Gotcha. Oh, stop screaming.
Oh, best smack.
Oh! Okay. Yes, Bridget Wilson for the win.
Sonya Blade for the win.
You know, she doesn't have to scream. That kind of reminds me of a toy from the 1960s where a kid would, like, have a hat, and if he took it off and he pressed a button, a little gun would pop out.
You can't really do that if you're dead now, can you?
Love this bit. Mandark?
Oh, that was great. That's a great entrance. Hi! I love that.
We need to see that in an R-rated action film, just see, like, instead of the bodies exploding stuff, I don't.
Oh shit. Hello! Ouch.
He's going by true lies logic.
You know, after a lot of the stunt work in this movie is pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm?
Don't give up your day job.
After about 100 different takes, that was the best improv line they could come up with.
What he should have said was, "For shame, using an elephant gun." Looney Tunes, no?
Oh.
Right. For shame, using an elephant gun. Elephant gun? Yes, why don't you go and shoot yourself an elephant? You do, and I'll give you such a pinch!
Of course he's wearing a bulletproof vest. And what was up with the score there? It sounded like there was a burping electric guitar. Where are
you going? I say, who did the score? Actually, that's what I want to
catch the red eye.
The red eye.
For red eye, get clear eye.
Dive, dive, dive!
Michael Kamen did the score for this film.
Okay, seriously, how in the world, why does he have a bike?
Yeah, that part I...
Well, he can't
understand.
Drive yet.
Well, of course he's 9 years old, but geez, can he just stay put or something? Don't get involved?
I mean, it sort of makes sense when he says that he realizes he's the comic relief, but at the same time, it's like, if you're gonna have a part in this film, since when did you have a part in this film?
Yeah, when you jumped in the film, you just had a role in the film all of a sudden.
That's how casting works for this movie, I guess. How many bullets does that gun have?
Infinite.
Many.
Oh, here we go.
Worst case of chicken ever.
Which is a bad stinking idea.
Called it. I wouldn't do that without a helmet. Just saying.
No, it's...
Yeah. You idiot!
Wait for it.
Yes, E.T.
E.T. is a better movie. Well, I'd say the other joke, but it's been done before.
Mm-hmm.
What the hell? Now what the hell?
Oh, yeah.
E.T. phone lawyer!
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, Michael came into the score for this film. He's done other films like La 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 La, Brazil, The Dead Zone, Pink Floyd's The Wall, Incorporation, Die Hard, License to Kill, Lethal Weapon 2, Die Hard 2. A lot of access. This guy's got like a massive filmography for scoring. Too bad he passed away a while ago.
Oh, hey, here's something interesting in the Fiasco book. It says, in the shooting of Battlefield Earth, the reason why they tilted the camera a lot was to make the aliens look like they were giants.
What does that have to do with this movie?
I don't know, I'm just padding up the running time.
We're not even an hour in. 2 minutes till we get to the hour mark, and...
Yeah.
Just
behind the eight ball now.
Yeah, a lot of glass eyeballs. Oh,
Santa,
no.
It's Santa Christ.
Oh, no. But towards the end of the film, once we hear his plan to use that ticket, it's just amazing.
By the way, it's really weird how they have the Twilight Zone theme coming up in a second.
Oh.
See?
That.
It's on the TV playing in the background. Clever.
That's kind of clever.
Yeah, but at the same time, it's kind of forced. Like, if it was like the Outer Limits, it'd be a little more subtle. Welcoming you to the Outer Limits.
That would have made more sense, actually. It's not really another dimension, but it's the Outer Limits of... Yeah.
I guess so.
So,
hey.
Do we have like a thing?
I have that police radio sound effect.
by the way, I just want to ask, what is the word that he etches in anyway?
Hold on. I don't know what... Let me see if I can find it here. I thought I read something about that.
Was it the F word? The C word?
At one point, Danny produces a piece of paper with a word, presumably the F word, or some variations written on it, and asks Slater to say it. Slater refuses, and Danny cites this as yet more evident that this is a film, as the F word was not allowed on the PG-13 films at the time the movie was made. However, the F word does actually appear in the movie, spoken by Lieutenant Decker during one of his rapid-fire rants at Slater.
Yeah, I was seeing the second time around, it's definitely at the tail end. He goes, fucking! I'll point it out when we're going to that scene. Ba-bomb.
Don't touch!
Ba-bomb.
There's their kaboom.
California raisins?
He's got the California raisins.
And yes, steam is coming out of his ears. This is totally a cartoon.
They took the chicken and did what?
What was he so mad about? The fact that he... somebody else activated a bomb?
I don't know. It's the typical Mad Lieutenant cliche.
Is that Humphrey Bogart?
Yes.
Yes.
All you left is like the worm aliens and Men in Black on a bagpipe.
And then all of a sudden you got Jeff Bridges walking in from R.I.P.D.
Oh God, no! Please, I hate that movie. Like seriously, now he was the dude, and now he's like doing roles where he's talking like the Kentucky Fried Colonel.
Colonel Sanders.
Yes, like, seriously, that and the Seventh Son. What the hell, man? He goes from like, well, that's your opinion, man, to like, literally, that's all he's doing in his movies now. It's really weird.
That could be because of True Grit, maybe.
But True Grit was a good movie.
Of course,
and Crazy Heart.
That one I didn't see.
Well, we might do an episode of Jeff Bridges in the future, actually.
Yeah. Dibs on the Fisher King.
You got it. I love this part.
Yeah, there's always one in the closet.
She came out of the closet.
But don't.
It's funny how he's got the same jacket, same clothes,
same gun.
Same boots.
No, Everybody's Hero is a bad animated movie that we don't talk about.
What bad animated movie we don't talk about?
The one that was supposedly directed by Christopher Reeves.
Christopher Reeves made a bad animated movie?
Yes.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Well, now you get to look it up while we watch the movie.
Oh, is it Whoopi Goldberg and it's like the New York Yankees or something?
Yes, and Rob Reiner is a baseball signed by Babe Ruth.
No, Whoopi Goldberg is the baseball bat.
The baseball bat? Rob Reiner is the baseball.
Yeah, I didn't see that film, and maybe it's a good thing I didn't.
Me neither.
Oh boy. The philosophy of the life of an action hero.
Oh hey, Robin Williams was in Everybody's Hero.
Oh.
It went uncredited.
So, and there's a lot of talking in this film.
Which is why we're over-talking with random trivia.
Yes, because the talking in this film is beyond boring. But the thing is that some trailers shown few deleted scenes and alternate scenes, like an extended Hamlet action scene where Schwarzenegger is in the water shooting at someone, Danny being blown away into the theater after Dynamite pops out of the screen, alternate take and angle for Slater's "I hate when that happens" line after he gets out of the tar pit, a couple of other deleted scenes from the original 140-minute long rough cut, including dialogue scene between Danny and Jack, in which Danny says how his father died from cancer, and is in a scene where a group of kids see Jack while he's walking across the streets in the rain while with Danny looking for Benedict, and they think he's Schwarzenegger, so they ask him for his autograph, which he signs.
Weird. It was probably like maybe, he probably signed it as in Jack Slater. And the kids are
Jack
like...
Jack Slater.
And the kids are like, oh, that's kinda cool.
Yep, they... Yeah, with all the dialogue in that scene, somehow the whole running gag with the other cars swerving to stop behind him just didn't sit well. Everything blows up in this movie.
Even water.
Everything's... I'd like to know how they did that.
Stay in a car.
No way, I'm coming with you.
Kid, let's say this is a movie. How many times have you heard someone say...
It's a Hilton.
...and the guy doesn't? What happens?
Oh, hey James, you want to know what movie that's playing on the TV monitor at the Blockbuster store?
You'll tell.
Thunderheart.
Cool.
Never heard of it.
Never heard of it either, but... Thunderheart stars Val Kilmer, Sam Shepard. A young mixed-blood FBI agent is assigned to work with a cynical veteran investigator on a murder on a poverty-stricken Sioux reservation.
And now, for no apparent reason, here's a random audio clip.
The last action hero and Jurassic Park, all in one picture. And this is why this is going to be the big splash and smash.
That was when he was getting brushed off at the La Brea tar pits. Zod?
Kneel before me!
Practice. No, you ruined the joke.
Let's see, I mentioned before, and Morgan, you were warned here when I said this, but Steven Spielberg was in talks for directing this film, but he took Schindler's List, and also Robert Zemeckis was at one point to direct this film.
Good call.
Robert Zemeckis would have worked, probably.
Yeah.
Spielberg, this just doesn't seem like his thing.
It's too hip for Spielberg.
Mm-hmm. Is this the gag where the bad guy talks too much?
As always, because it's a sad type of action movies.
You made the classic movie mistake. Don't explain so
Yep, you just said it.
Ironic how he's saying it too. Look out, it's the man with the golden gun!
That's Mr. T.
I pity the fool who keeps on monologuing. Oh, here we go.
That would have worked if he was actually wearing the eight ball, but okay.
That would actually work if there was smoke coming out of his back.
Saved by Whiskers.
Mm-hmm.
Saved by a fucking cartoon cat.
That is Danny DeVito.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I told you.
It's the original Rocket Raccoon there.
No, 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 oh god, no, no, that's not Rocket Raccoon, that's the fucking Lorax. No, no, no,
right.
No one disses the Rocket, alright?
No.
Good god, Secret Wars, number one, he defended his goddamn life against the Children of Tomorrow, and what happens? He gets shot in the fucking back. Thanks, Marvel. Then again, he is coming back.
Mm-hmm. But seriously, though, I think that cartoon cat character would have been a... should have had his own movie there.
A spin-off movie, that would be nice.
He did, and it's called Zootopia.
Ha. Ha ha. Ha ha.
No, no, wait, he did, and it's called Bonkers.
Ah. That show was awful.
I loved it. Anyway.
The crane!
And yeah, you don't even... You're gonna know how to operate that thing, kid?
Of course, in the movies, you always know what to operate.
Yeah, Mighty Morphin Power Rangers the movie, We're Back a Dinosaur Story, Max Keeble's Big Move...
You're not looking at your library again.
Nah, I just know it.
Wow. Damn, this guy's good, folks.
Too good.
Love this. Okay, some of the bits here are actually pretty funny.
There's some good stuff in this film, but it drags on way too long.
I'll put my hand right up in my mouth. Okay, this bit.
Mm-hmm. Elephant, where?
The one in the room.
No. It should have been, look, orange. Get it, Godfather?
Mm-hmm.
Serious?
Even the nuns have guns there.
Hey.
You see, folks?
Oh,
an
God,
armed society is
nuns.
A polite society.
Hey, even a messenger of God needs protection, yo.
Mm-hmm.
I do not want to mention the that one film that features nuns and guns.
What do you mean, the Sound of Music?
I'm referring to the
Of course the hero can't get shot.
Referring to the Tales on 2010 movie, Nude Nuns with Big Guns.
Never seen it.
Yeah.
Hey, James, doesn't this remind me of that Cheech and Chong movie where, like, Chong was, like, hanging on the elevator naked?
Unfortunately.
Nice.
Now that you mentioned it.
Oh my goodness, Nice Dreams was bad.
Yeah.
The only good moments of that movie was with Paul Rubens and the guy turning into a freaky lizard because of the mutant weed.
Mm-hmm. Hello, Charlie. Why aren't you in the great glass elevator?
Red Room!
Red Rum.
No, it's Red
Run.
Room. Twin Peaks.
We're shooting The Shining in there. Get it? Shooting? Ha ha ha.
First floor, Duex Machina's lingerie.
So that's where the blood gets off at the second floor.
Really?
Huh? What?
Yep, taken down by a kid with a crane.
Again, this is a parody of Die Hard.
Stunt double!
Of course. I think you can hear the Die Hard theme a little bit in the score. Or, yeah. Oh, look at me, I'm doing a comedic fool!
I hope I can fly.
Superman can fly after all.
It would have been funny if, as he was falling, it's like a side shot and then Gruber comes out of nowhere just falling.
Next to him.
That would have been a great cameo, actually.
Like, hang on! Let me get a touch of your fork!
Actually, I didn't mention that to you, Morgan, because I told James it while you were away, but Alan Rickman was considered for the role of Benedict, but he turned it down for salary reasons, and Charles Dance wore a shirt that said, I'm cheaper than Alan Rickman.
Oh, well, they still got a good actor. You know, if the bomb is attached to the tie, why don't you just rip off the tie?
Take off. I don't know. I don't even know where the bomb is. Is it inside him? So the timer was in the watch, and I guess the watch was connected to something.
Kind of like the bomb earlier attached to Art Carney.
Mm-hmm. Funny, didn't that watch say 13 or 14 seconds?
Maybe, I don't know.
How long is it
taking? Hey, you can see the tracks where Arnold's coming out.
Oh.
Here comes a big bubble.
Meanwhile, at the supervillains hideout.
My goodness, it's the sphere.
No, it's that thing from the Creepshow 2, the raft, the little toxic creature.
Or maybe that's where they buried the bubble craft in Explorers. I'm smart.
Yeah. Badass Bridget Wilson.
I did absolutely nothing in this movie.
Just look pretty for the young male viewers out there.
Well, just enjoy it.
Exactly. This is the problem I have with the kid character.
I know. Ugh.
Let's see, 2-for-1 coupon for the Heaven Pearly Gates. Better keep this one for the sequel.
I get to walk into all my favorite movies this way.
I get to be in my favorite movies ever!
You know, I just had a really dark joke. He's a villain, right? If he can walk into films, you kind of think the millions and millions of pornos he could walk into.
That could be. Makes sense.
Actually, this is what the producers of Terminator Genesis are thinking. We will use this movie ticket to create our own expanded universe!
Oh, man. I'm so gonna bitch about that one on the podcast. I got so many problems with that movie. And for fuck's sake, I'm the only one who saw that movie out of the team. Really? I'm the only person who saw that movie? Fuck all of you right now. Damn it. I'm the only one who's gonna suffer. Thanks, guys. Thanks.
Do you want to hear the voicemail Morgan sent him to me?
Yes, he was our guinea pig.
And I regret it. Seriously, I was walking out of that movie, and right next to them, like marquees for Jurassic World and Inside Out.
Mission, set a vlog. I know.
Is he talking to the movie? Is he talking to the us?
Breaking the fourth wall?
I think he's talking to the producers.
Oh.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
Here comes Kool-Aid. Here comes Kool-Aid. It's gonna stop the film.
Yep. He's just gone Roadhouse on him.
Roadhouse.
How do we know he's a bad guy now? Because Watson said so.
Oh, I forgot about the ex-wife's house. The ex-wife's house that was blown up was actually in a previous film.
Okay. Great line coming up.
He's got the last ticket.
Let's see, what would a machine do with a life supply of chocolate?
What would a villain do with a life supply of chocolate?
I am not telling the computer exactly what it can do with a villain's life supply time of chocolate.
Make fake eyeballs.
Look, all you want to do is make lollipops and Leonard Pot snakes. So yeah, I should probably explain how this movie ended up becoming a huge, huge flop on arrival. let's see here. Here we go. Let's see. Everyone's in high spirits as they continue to shoot Winter. However, director John McTiernan knew better than anyone how the day-to-day filming was faring was concerned. Unlike the others who were blinded by dollar signs, he sensed that some scenes within the film were not playing effectively and would require a great deal of the usual fine-tuning. But with the film's June 1993 opening looming ever nearer, it became more apparent to him that the insufficient time was being allowed for necessary post-production steps so key to the success. He was crucified by the immunity of the release date and argued on Arnold for pushing the picture out to a later date. Canton insisted the release schedule must be strictly adhered to. If it wasn't, he explained, it would send a message to the industry and the media that is the picture was in trouble. Also, as you might as well guess, films go through like a post-production test screening, of course. And this film had its first test screening on May 1st in Lakewood in a 1,000-seat theater in the shopping mall complex located 18 miles southeast of downtown Los Angeles, which was north of Long Beach. Oh boy, here I go. In all fairness, what was presented to the test audience was an extremely rough cut, without the final dialogue dubs or score, and many of the action scenes still lack the full array of planned special effects. Director McTiernan said, "I had great trepidation about showing the movie in that state. However, the director seemingly over-anxious to convince himself that everything would work out okay aloud after the fact that he had felt quite relieved at the screening because he had an audience not tolerating technical flaws anywhere near as well." Besides the test audience, theater that night was filled with top-ranking Columbia front office executives, as well as some pivotal producer production figures as Schwarzenegger and Tyrion. The film's insiders did not need to wait until the 138-minute version finished on school big judgment. They knew from their own reactions, let alone that of the civilians of the audience, that the picture was hardly living up to inflated expectations. Naturally, none of the studio brass acknowledged one another that they were witnessing a hugely cost picture sinking from their eyes. Of all those at the Lakewood Theater, Mark Canton was the most upset since the potential defeat would be laid directly at his doorstep. Rushing into action, he prevented the market research staffers from collecting the ominous audience response cards. He knew that few of those score sheets would rate Last Action Hero as a must-see. Gathering together the telltale evidence, the Columbia executive quickly decided not to share the infuriated bad news on the cards with either filmmaker or the star. Canton responded, and I quote, "I didn't want the director, who had literally been working 18 hours a day, and our star to come up with 14 more ideas that would take 3 weeks. We didn't have 3 weeks."
Mm.
But oh, there's
so part of it was reshot?
Yeah. Well, oh,
okay.
Yeah, exactly. But there's more. Following the disastrous Lakewood Center screening, Mark Canton and his underlinings did everything possible to avoid having news of the moviegoers' negative response to the film reach the press. He ordered that the telltale survey cards be shredded. He instructed everyone that when the media called Columbia to inquire about the showing, news of which had already leaked out, the official word was that the test screening had generated no audience response statistics whatsoever. None of the callers brought this sensational explanation. Thereafter, what Canton and everyone feared most actually happened. Bad word of mouth about the forthcoming release spread throughout the industry and to the media. In retrospect, many agreed that if the much-held production had been entered into a far humbler way, and if the studio had its star had not so instantly and smoothly proclaimed that they were packaging the big ticket 1983, far fewer news sources would have been gunning to bring down the extremely expensive venture. Panic can lead to disastrous executive decisions. Such was the case when a Los Angeles Times article appeared and headlined, "Phantom Screening, You Haven't Heard the Last About Action Hero." Relying on several undisclosed industry sources, the piece referenced a supposed recent Last Action Hero test screening held at a multiplex theater in Pasadena, California that had gone badly. The article noted that the studio denied any such Pasadena screening. Days later, Entertainment Weekly published a cover story dissecrating the troubled pending release and its exhibitor costs. One of the contributors to the National Magazine piece was Jeffrey Wells, the Los Angeles Times reporter. Wells' actions led to a much-reported showdown in June between Columbia executives and the Los Angeles Times. Fighting mad, the film threw its impressive weight around an ensuing battle royale. Columbia wrote the Times a letter threatening to cut off all studio advertising. The paper refused all interview queries from the publication and so forth unless the newspaper agreed not to publish any future pieces by Wells that even alluded to Columbia Pictures. This back-and-forth power moving eventually ended in a stalemate in which both parties quickly backed down. However, the studio's knee-jerk response to the initial Times article, which was later proved to have been an error about the Pasadena screening, set off a tidal wave of articles from a large number of publications. These pieces, discreet and editorialized, will abuse chutzpah in so... Oh, sorry. I thought I saw something. Anyway. These pieces dissected and editorialized all these chutzpah is so ideolocated trying to steamroll the media. In the process, the publication has found ways to prevent the accumulated negative information on the yet-to-be-released party rambasted movie. So yeah, to answer your question about the reshoots, at the end of Prince of Photography and after the unfortunate May 1st, 1993 test screening, several scenes in Last Action Hero underwent retakes and or supplemented with new footage. The intent was to patch up the picture's worst narrative holes and to improve other sequences that notably slowed down the action. This last-minute rescue operation was accomplished under the tremendous pressure of the fast-approaching release date. Because of the haste of the new filming, it proved to be extra costly and added to the movie's bursting budget, which rumor now had escalated its initial $16 million ceiling. Some sources estimated the cost to be past the $100 million mark. For the cast and crew doing the repair work on Last Action Hero, it was a tough situation. They were attempting to salvage a movie that both reality and the industry's and the press's perception already had categorized as a disaster. It was difficult for most of them to generate the needed enthusiasm to carry throughout with their band-aid chores.
Dang.
Yeah. It was pretty tough. The sign says Head Crusher Bloodthirst. I think they're like earlier signs we saw at the beginning. I'm just trying to remember them.
These are all movies that you would find in the bargain bin at the Kmart.
Should I mention about Braunschweiger?
No, actually.
Yeah, Jack said I was trying to pose as Arnold Schwarzenegger in the real world. He keeps getting the name wrong, calling him Arnold Braunschweiger. This is going to be a little fun fact for you. The first part of Arnold's real name, Schwartz, means black in German, while the first part of his wrong name, Braun, means brown in German. Also, Braunschweiger is a type of liverwurst made in Braunschweiger or Braunschweig, Germany. In the German dub, he calls himself Arnold Beckenberm, pool builder.
You know, for a PG-13 movie, there's a lot of adult video stores.
Well,
yeah. Well, that's so long as they show the outside of it, that's fine, right?
I mean, this is the second half of the movie I always have problems with, because when you have the film world invading reality, there's always this distinction between what you know can happen in reality between the film logic. And a good example is this scene right here where he shoots the guy. In a sense, you know, I remember seeing this first time around and kind of laughing at the idea. Now, after seeing it again, I kind of have to agree with Rob. In a post-9/11 world, this kind of thing wouldn't have happened.
Right.
I shot a man! Seriously, someone has to call the police.
I say, you can see a guy in the background stealing a pair of shoes.
I said I have murdered a man, and I want to confess.
See, he's just figuring out if this is it a movie or is it real life.
And that's kind of the problem.
It's like, pushing it just a little bit there.
Yeah, it's a bit
this
dark.
This is supposed
yeah.
to be the real world, and we have a darkly humorous scene right there that comes across as yeah right.
I mean, really think about it. Would that kind of thing actually happen in real life?
Probably not as not as depicted, but
yeah. I mean, I don't want to, you know, crash reality or anything, but seriously, there's, like, all these news reports going on throughout day by day, so it makes you kind of think, really, will this kind of thing happen? And that's the problem with this last half hour of the film. It really pushes suspension of disbelief way too much. Because we just went through this whole cartoon action reality, action-packed reality, and here we are in what is supposed to be reality. But then again, at the same time, with things like magic tickets, it's sort of like, well, wait a minute, is this supposed to be like a film reality or a film within a film reality? This is where the film really gets confusing on its logic.
Big surprise. It's all a movie. What do you know?
Yes, yes, some writer wakes up and he's like, whoa, Morty, I just had this really, really good idea for a movie. Like Arnold Schwarzenegger's like an action hero or something, and like he gets pulled through into like real life New York City. I think it's called Collateral Damage.
I did want to mention, Morgan, off the cut here, when you sent me that Rick and Morty season 1 for binge watching,
yeah,
the video footage is all fucked up. Like, the audio's fine, but the video was just, like, flickering.
Did you try opening up in VLC?
No, I don't have that. Gee, I wish I knew that ahead of time.
There you go.
That and also a QuickTime.
Damn it. Nobody tells me this shit, man. It's just...
You gotta get with the times, man! Even fat grandma knows well!
Actually, I just realized there was no opening credits for The Last Action Hero.
Yeah, I was about to say, what was up with that?
The only opening credits in this movie was for Jack Slater 4, the movie within a movie.
Yeah, and that had the 80s Columbia logo, which was weird.
Yeah, that was weird, actually.
And I think I have the explanation for that. Oh yeah, here it is. 1987, that was the year when Columbia bombed big time with Ishtar and Leonard Part 6. They weren't doing so good, and that's because Coca-Cola was taking over Columbia. And around that point, the Sony Corporation decided to pretty much just buy them out.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, they bought...
Oh, so that explains the Coca-Cola in here?
Yeah, I was gonna say,
In a sense, kind of. Like, in 1987, you know, Coca-Cola gave up Columbia, and Sony acquired the Columbia Pictures for, like, $200 million, plus provide the Fast Living new co-chairman a generous compensation package.
Mm-hmm.
So in 1991, the studio complex got renamed to Sony Pictures Entertainment, and that's pretty much why today everything is now Sony instead of such.
Ooh.
Night of the Living Dead.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you.
By the way, that reminds me, at some point we gotta watch The Cotton Club. I heard, like, some positive things about it. It's actually one of Frank Devonport's favorite films.
Yeah, never heard of it.
It's directed by Francis Ford Coppola. It's a pretty, pretty infamous bomb that's supposed to be like this movie based on a club in the 1920s that African Americans worked in.
Oh, just like in a movie, the bad guy shows up somewhere, right?
See what I mean?
Again, here's what you're saying. Yeah, bending reality.
Pretty much.
Wow, usually in the movies I have a stunt double do that for me.
But now Arnold is the stunt double. See, look, he tore the door off. You don't do that in reality. You don't tear the door off. That's a disservice to the cabbies. Especially if they look like Gene Siskel.
No.
No wonder why he gave this movie thumbs down.
Just for that line alone.
Rubber baby buggy bumpers.
Yes, Oh, there's the four-story inflatable Jack Slater.
Yeah, originally he had stacks of dime in his hand, but due to an incident in New York, they changed it to a police badge.
Yeah, right. Shriver.
Yeah, there he is.
A lot of cameos. Little Richard.
This is Little Richard after recording his song for We're Back, apparently.
Yeah, they just probably took him off the set and say, like, you gotta do cameo. So here's something that doesn't make sense. He plans to kill Arnold Schwarzenegger. Arnold Schwarzenegger in real life. You have Jack Slater, Arnold Schwarzenegger. What success would it be in killing him? Would it erase Jack Slater from existence?
Yeah, they were just talking about that, actually.
They were
just talking about that. Yeah, without Arnold Schwarzenegger, like, Jack Slater would just, like, disappear. Poof.
It's Terminator logic, actually.
Yes, actually.
Instead of traveling back through time, you travel through dimensions.
Now, there was a joke, I don't know if we missed or not, but there was a really good bit where the Danny character is talking about the villain and how in another movie he played a character that quote-unquote killed Mozart.
Mm.
It was a joke.
I don't know.
The joke is he was an Amadeus and he played like the main character or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. I guess I missed that. Maybe I'll just have to rewatch this movie sometime.
You're like, don't you remember he killed Amadeus?
I thought this was the way to Comic Con.
That is this weekend too, I think.
Oh yeah.
Oh my goodness. It's Tom. Hi, Richter Cummin. We miss you.
What? Yeah. Jim Belushi. He later works with Arnold in Red Heat.
Ooh, is that the one where they open up with the sun and you see Arnold's ass again?
I think so. It's been a while since I've seen it. That's when he did the Russian accent.
Yeah, he like shoves a commie in the a Russian stuff or something.
I gotta see that again.
Oh, there's a Total Recall post from the back.
Oh, clever.
Well, yeah, the Sharon Stone cameo earlier was just because Arnold worked with her in Total Recall. Oh, Chevy Chase and Damon Wayans.
Oh, look, it's the original billboard there with, like, the dynamite in his hand.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, Jean-Claude Van Damme.
Just because...
Oh, that was a stupid joke.
Where am I?
Yeah. Where am I sitting?
I feel like where I sat down.
Okay, seriously, nobody
this
notices.
This will be inconspicuous.
Seriously, a trench coat? A trench coat.
Yeah.
Upper, lower, upper,
MC
lower.
Hammer!
Hey, I gotta go mess up the Addams Family movie.
Too legit to quit.
That reminds me of a really good joke from Scary Movie, but it's cut. I think it's on some television airings where Brenda gets a phone call, and Cindy's like, was it the killer? And Brenda's like, no, that was MC Hammer. Talk about a brother who came and managed his own money.
Oh.
Thankfully, it airs on Comedy Central.
So, is this a special effect, or did he use Arnold's twin?
Wait, Arnold had a twin?
It's probably a special effect, actually. There's no stunt double, it's just... I don't know. Flashback?
Oh man, this makes a nice pre-show.
Yes, it does.
I want to have a movie premiere like this one day.
Have characters from the previous.
I think this joke kind of worked in Back in Action.
Oh.
Where Brendan Fraser hits himself.
Oh yeah.
I mean, it was weird and didn't make any sense.
Well, what did I do?
Nothing.
Make the eraser.
You see, anybody special? Just believe you have that cliched upwording.
Oh my. They're doing this shit again.
Yes.
Yep. Yep, this is the third act. This is that cliched moment where the hero has to face his fears because whatever.
Fuji!
I wonder if Arnold still has that 4-foot inflatable.
Yeah, it's like once in a while it's like, on 4th of July, I just like to blow it up and get attention in the neighborhood. It tells all the dogs to not piss on my lawn. But then mean James Cameron comes over with this giant robot from Avatar and pops it. As a way to upstage me.
Oh shit.
It's okay, the kid can fly. He's seen Mark.
Now, time for your suspension of disbelief.
Oh yeah, this is it's weird.
This is a different version of Batman, Mr. Freeze versus Zazz.
Don't touch the water.
It's electric.
Boogie, 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 boogie,
boogie. Jinx.
Boogity 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 boogity.
Well, he said it. He said it. He said it. He said he'd be back.
But wait a minute. He's wearing rubber.
Don't question it. The movie will be over quicker.
I hope that gargoyle doesn't come to life.
Hey, they're ripping off Blade Runner.
It's homage. Not ripping off.
I don't know what he's doing to that gargoyle, but it looks dirty.
Hey, this isn't Naked Gun, alright?
Get out of here.
he's holding on to that gargoyle by the pecker. I couldn't resist.
And you let your hands go, and I will catch you. Okay? Is he wearing Nikes?
Is he trolling? Come on, Danny.
Yes. No, no, the line is, come with me if you want to live.
Acme.
See what I mean?
But this is... That wasn't... This is real life, so why is Acme...
You see my problem with this film?
And they just made a whipping noise as he threw him up there.
It's a... No, no, the line is, I need a vacation. Oh, yes, 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 yes.
Wouldn't it be kind of cool if the ending he actually summoned all those villains?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, from Jack Slater 2, Jack Slater 1.
No, 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 I mean, like, actually bringing those things into the real world, like Dracula, King Kong, and Hannibal Lecter.
Freddy Krueger. All those. That's what he was. Because that was. Dracula? I can get King Kong! Yeah, I was, like, imagining, like, King Kong would come out of nowhere, like,
that would have been so cool.
That would have been so badass if they just came right up behind him and just, like, oh shit. All I have to do
is snap my fingers and they'll be here. They're lining up to get you. I mean,
that would be...
That would have been the ultimate ending.
Yeah, the ultimate.
Yeah, the
ultimate.
Ones that... The ones oh. That could, they
yeah,
could
the rights
get their
would
hands
be...
on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, this is like the... Roger Rabbit of action films.
Or tried to be.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the people who wrote the script, they researched Purple Rose of Cario and Die Hard, and this is more or less influenced from Purple Rose of Cario by Woody Allen, which shares similar story ideas if you haven't seen it. It's about a woman that keeps on seeing this movie, and then like the 25th or 50th time, whatever, the characters start moving out of the screen and merging into reality. And then, like, what happens is once they leave the movie, all the people within the movie are confused. They're like, should we continue the movie? I don't know if we should. Should we continue the movie? I don't know if we should. They're gone. What should we do? I don't know. Because it's like, they can't continue the film without the main stars, and so they try to go from there. I haven't seen
it. Oh, yeah.
But it sounds pretty cool. It's Woody Allen.
What are you talking about, the Purple Rose of Cairo?
Yes.
Yeah. That's a good movie.
Why are we watching that?
Putting that on my two commentary list. Okay, got it.
Now, the whole ordeal with the ticket, I am really confused. Like, does the Grim Reaper put the ticket in the box, or does the box have the other half of the ticket? And furthermore, how is the Grim Reaper able to move off the screen when he's not even in contact with the ticket? Though I do admit this shot is pretty cool.
That is. I think the ticket has to be within the area of the theater to actually work.
Yeah. Like, I remember seeing that as a kid on the TV screen, and when the side went through the screen, I was like, holy shit, this is gonna get good.
Man! This 3D movie stuff is really kicking off.
Why are you saying that? They're not. They're not gonna understand you or believe you. Holy shit, no!
Who left a.
See, this is
who let the kid have a gun in the movie?
Like, seriously, isn't the real world is meshing with the action movie world?
That would have explained a lot.
Yeah.
You know what? We should launch a movie theory about this.
Oh, you're
you know
dead.
Those fan theories that that always try to explain the movies when the movies don't do enough explaining?
Mm-hmm.
You know, like Ferris Bueller's really a figment of Cameron's imagination, that sort of thing.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Isn't that Ian McKellen?
Yes, it is.
Cool.
Yes, it is. He's actually playing the Grim Reaper slash Death of the film Seventh Seal that came out in 1957.
Wouldn't that be funny if, like, he's walking on the theater screen and then, like, trying to get Jack Slater, and then Danny's all like, "You shall not pass!"
Oh, this is before Lord of the Rings, so...
I know.
Really lovely timing wimey stuff.
So, like, the ticket is now on the street, and now the other half of the ticket is in that.
Yeah, yes, the other half of the ticket is in the bin, so that's how Danny is like, "Oh, shit, I gotta grab the other half of the ticket."
And how does that guy still have copies of Jack Slater 4? Is he supposed to, like, return them before, like, some big premiere date?
Guess not.
Which, like, oh shit.
Or maybe it's like an advanced copy or something. I don't know. Okay, I will admit there's at least one small subtle joke I do like here. This right here, where he mentions, "Oh, he can't go with me. He's not due."
My list.
No, nope. Shh, it's a Smith. This one. Now that is pretty simple.
Mm-hmm. Attention.
I'm death, you idiot.
Not life.
So, need I remind you, this ending originally had the projectionist revealing to be the devil. It was a twist that was considered way out there that in the end, it got
cut. Yeah, that's kind of stupid.
Oh, where's the ticket? Where's the ticket?
Gold! 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 Yes. So yeah, while we watch this ending, I'm probably going to mention the fate of this movie for those who don't know if this film bombed the box office or not. Spoiler alert. Again, straight from the book Fiasco, the PG-13 rated Last Action Hero had its world premiere in Westwood, Los Angeles, although Columbia expended $500,000 in the gala and invited 2,300 guests. The turnout was not very star-studded. Many celebrities chose to bypass the event, not wanting to sit through the unpromising surrounding, or worse, have the fiasco somehow rub off them. Meanwhile, that same weekend, the competition Jurassic Park debuted throughout North America. The Universal release took in a record-shattering $50.1 million at the box office and generated the kind of audience excitement that promised a long, profitable payoff. The picture saw a success meant that Beauregard Last Action Hero would open the next Friday in competition with a proven box office winner that, unlike Hero, with inspiring terrific cause of word mouth, what made the situation even more upsetting to Sony executives back in Japan was that Universal's parent company was Matsushita, a rival Japanese electronics giant. Cementing Columbia's panic, the early reviews of Last Action Hero in the trade papers could not have been more devastating. back at Columbia Pictures, everyone was engaged in damage control, trying to create a positive spin somehow for their already much lambasted obese blockbuster. Caught in the paranoia that the world was maliciously out to bury the Colossi picture, Canton and his staff sought to plug any internal leaks in the studio that might further fuel negative perceptions of the Last Action Hero. In the process, Columbia officials slammed particular members of the press who were seemingly out to destroy a perfectly good picture. As it turns out, they were apparently a well-placed executive on the Columbia lot who had been getting revenge for past slights by spilling confidential news on Last Action Hero to the eager media. As Longo decreed, it opened as scheduled in mid-June 1993 at nearly 2,000 horror theaters. Even adding in the revenue from the special Thursday night showings, the picture's initial weekend gross was a relative tight-lipped $15.3 million. In a face-saving gesture, Columbia officials insisted to the trade press that they were very, very, very happy with the box office numbers thus far. However, in its second weekend release, the blockbuster that was not to be brought in only 8 million, dropping off a steep 47% from its prior week, blah, 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 for a picture that had cost a crunching 83.1 to 120 million. The final tally was catastrophic, even with the later anecdotally sales from pay, TV, video rentals, and sales. One of the few merchandising elements Last Action Hero that did work well was its soundtrack album, which actually rose number 7 on the Billboard Music Charts. And I'll talk about the epilogue later because we have to hear the F word, which is actually coming up.
And that was kind of a nice moment there.
Oh yeah, that is a pretty nice moment. Listen, it's coming up.
Yep, there it is.
Yeah.
Which makes no sense. So.
In the summer of 1993, as Last Action Hero rapidly faded from the article distribution of many of its merchandising tie-ins gathered dust on the shelves, Mark Canton reflected on his decision to jump into a release date and stand by it by no matter what. He said, and I quote, "I would never again want to make that date. You're promising something too extraordinary, and it can cause a backlash." Attempting a philosophical approach to his public humiliation, Canton noted, "Failure is not the end game. It is an almost inevitable cul-de-sac on the road to success." A dismayed John McTiernan observed, "In some of the circumstances, people might have, if not applauded, at least noticed the attempt to make an honest movie." The director added, We really got trumped on a dinosaur, period. As for Schwarzenegger, he allowed, and I quote, "In hindsight, if the kids see PG-13, they say, well, I've heard you talk about that, Arnold. You want to tone down the violence. I'm not interested in that. I want to have limbs come off. I want to have heads come off in Total Recall. I want to see bodies flying around." In assessing the gigantic career of his adventure, Schwarzenegger certainly could have summarized the bad experience with the catchphrases of his Last Action Hero character, "Big mistake." Having offered their weak mea culpas, which did not struggle that any of the guilty parties accepted any meaningful responsibility for their costly filmmaking era, Canton, Schwarzenegger, and the other key decision makers involved in the crash, disappointing Last Action Hero role too eager to move on and forget the landmark fiasco, it seemed doubtful that they had really learned from their gigantic industry mess. Interviewing why the industry and the media had become so vicious in attacks against the Last Action Hero, a former producer chief from another studio assessed at the time, and I quote, "Because it was made so irresponsibly. That has to do with throwing so much money into the plot and not handling it properly." And then next year we had True Lies, and that made everything better.
Yeah. True.
Yeah.
There's a major plot hole in the ending here. Like, we never see Death / Grim Reaper go back into the Seventh Seal, so he must be out loose in New York killing people.
Oh well, maybe he just went back to his movie.
But we don't see it.
He was like, "I am bored of this place. There is no good Swedishness in here. This is cold, this is damp. I'm going back to my black and white domain." But no, I remember Last Action Hero. Mm-hmm. I remember going to like a Burger King, and they always had the poster out, even when the movie was out in the theaters, and that was the first time I remember seeing it. And then later, I think I first saw it on TNT, and then I read the junior novelization at my school. And then finally, I saw this film in full, and I was kind of like, I guess I kind of like it. It's got some good things, I guess. And then I thought more about it, and after a few showings, I realized, wow, this movie's got problems.
Yeah. I mean, you can sit back and nitpick this to death, but at the end of the day, I think that if you're gonna enjoy this, just sort of don't think too much about it.
Yeah, I mean, obviously.
I mean, it's not a bad movie.
No, it's just there's been films before that that have done this angle better. Hey, hello, Richard Harris. I didn't know you did this movie. You later on to restore things like Mad, Mad, Mad World and Hitchcock. Anyway, I think the problem is that this idea has been done before, but it's not the case of a disservice to originality. It's more like it wasn't handled well. Like, it wasn't really handled that well, and you can obviously see why in the film. The action film is pretty much a kid's perspective of an action film. It's not really, like, a full-blown thing. Like, if the kid went into, like, a version of Terminator 2, now, that would have been actually kind of a lot of fun.
Even though that was also from a kid's perspective.
Well, yeah, but at the same time, it was gritty, it didn't hold back, and at the very least, that was more of a... That was more of an action film than this movie, when you really think about it. Because obviously they were trying to do, like, this whole parody or something. You know, I kind of would have been like if Mel Brooks was behind this.
That would be interesting, actually.
Like, think about it. If they did, like, this whole Blazing Saddles take, it would have been interesting.
That would be, actually.
Yeah. Like, get rid of the cartoon cat, make it all about, like, a parody of action films in general, not just trying to be, like, a parody of buddy cop comedies or something like that. And have the kid be interested in the action world. Make him be like, wow, this is a movie I can finally meddle in and be like one of the characters and stuff. That would have been great instead of, you know, just simply saying, hey, we can break the rules and stuff. Like maybe if it was like Inception or Dreamscape, that would be a lot more interesting.
I'm still listening to the credits. For some reason, they just switched over to a live rendition of Dream On.
Dream On, yeah. I noticed that too when I was skimming. Look, it's Noonan!
Yep.
Noonan!
I guess so.
And look, there's the cameos they wasted.
Oh!
Fun fact, if you look really close, you won't see a credit for Danny DeVito. I have no idea why.
Why would he be embarrassed about this?
No.
Cop at ex-wife's house.
Mm-hmm. So, if you really want something that sucks, though, that came from this, there was a Game Gear game.
Oh, yeah.
And I played it probably once, and I never went back to it. A friend of mine had owned it, I'd borrowed it, and my god, you play as Jack Slater in the game, going around from level to level, getting shot out by bad guys, but your only weapon is your fist. God, that is one shot and you die. Or one shot and you get knocked up of something and then you die. I mean, good God.
By the way, as we're going up here, cock the hammer, that should be a meme.
That's what I just said, cock the hammer.
I mean, I understand.
Yeah,
I understand the movie's going under the logic that a hero can't die, but for a video game spinoff, you don't want to make it too frustrating to piss off your gamer.
Yeah, there was some games produced for this film.
We're back at Dinosaur Strike.
Oh, look, Blockbuster.
Yes.
Oh, yes. Well, I played the Genesis version, you know, the one where you had to fight the giant bellhop.
Oh, yeah. So, any final thoughts, Mike?
It's a guilty pleasure of mine, actually. I mean...
Yeah, I'd probably say the same.
Just... Even though it has all its flaws and all the production history behind it, it's got some clever moments with lines and action shots and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe I should get the Blu-ray. This actually wouldn't be bad to have in my collection.
Yeah, there you go.
There you go, yeah, that'd be... For those collectors out there, it doesn't matter how bad the movie is, you gotta collect it somehow.
So, yeah, I guess this is just something that when I saw this as a kid, I remember watching this at a hotel, I think was the first time I saw it. It was on HBO, and it. I was just at the right age where, you know, even though this is PG-13, some of the stuff in there was, you know, stuff I'd already played in the video games, so my folks didn't mind watching it on TV or anything like that. And so we just sat down and watched it, and it kind of blew my mind for a little while. I mean, I hadn't seen a movie quite this intense at that time. It was something that bent the rules a little bit for me. So, I guess you could say I consider it a guilty pleasure as well.
Yeah.
Only one that I'll not necessarily be going out of my way to watch every year or so. Maybe like 10 years goes in between viewings here.
Well, I guess to close it all off, there's actually something interesting here, again from the book Fiasco. There's like a good passage in the front where they're talking about how Hollywood is using blockbusters and big bloated budget films to use as like the cesspool of success. And there's a bit here that goes on about how Jeffrey Katzenberg of Disney Studios began to ponder the ongoing fiscal responsibility, and in late 1990 he wrote an inter-office memo that was somehow leaked to the media. His famous memorandum focused on the industry mania that was leading to continuous financial mayhem on the studio lots. He observed, and I quote, "Each of us is trying to outrun and outspend and out-earn the other in a mad spring towards the mirage of the next blockbuster." He bemoaned that this box office mania was fostering a frenzy among actors, writers, directors, and their agents, adding, "The time has come to get back to our roots. If we remain in our current course, there will be the certainty of calamitous failure." In summation, he warned, "We should now take a long and hard look at the blockbuster business and get out of it." And it's kind of funny because this chapter on Last Action Hero starts off with a quote from Columbia Pictures chairman Mark Canton, which says, "We're still making expensive movies, but only when they are very good bets. More often today, we're making films for $15 million that would have cost $20 or $25 million 3 years ago. We've stopped overpaying. We're making the right film at the right price. We're leaner and much more flexible. We used to say we wanted no matter how much it costs. Now we've adopted the mantra of all well-run businesses. We want it, but only if the price is right. Or if Arnold Schwarzenegger is in it." And I think that perfectly sums up this film.
Yeah.
And we've learned so much about making blockbusters, haven't we?
Seriously, people, go
to the
nearest library.
We've learned not to make the same mistakes.
Go to the nearest library and get this book. It's amazing. It has, it's called Fiasco, History of Hollywood Iconic Flops. It's got stuff on Cleopatra, Paint Your Wagon, Waterworld, Popeye, Showgirls, Battlefield Earth, Ishtar, and even Town and Country. There's even like a whole section on Town and Country where, believe it or not, someone actually stole a whole bunch of film and they had to like reshoot the scenes that were stolen.
There you go, people.
Seriously, it's worth checking out along just for that.
For your summer reading, check it out at your local library. Thanks for listening to this extended edition commentary of Last Action Hero. Comment below, what other films should we do a commentary on? I'll definitely make a list of it. Thanks for listening, and see you in the next commentary.
Now go to the chopper.
Ciao for now.
La 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 la